So our first speaker this afternoon is Vadim Kaloshin, and we'll talk about conjugacy of convex pairs.
Thank you. So I'll talk about a joint work with Alfonso Sorrentino, and to tell you the truth, I had a little time to prepare the abstract. So the abstract contains probably one quarter of what I would like to say. I had a deadline of about 2 hours to write it. So so I'll start with convex billiards as my main mathematical model. And then I'll introduce so-called lens spectrum. And mention a variety of conjectures which were mainly posed by Melrose and Guillemin. And after this, I'll state the main result. And as you'll see, the main result is actually motivated by one of those conjectures. And it turns out that the main result plus a certain what we call extension problem could solve one of those conjectures. But in order to explain what is the problem, and we call it extension problem, I need to introduce so-called Mazur alpha and beta functions. And after I introduce Mazur and beta functions, I need to explain you about Lazutkin caustics. And after I explain you what the Lazutkin caustics, I'll tell you that Lazutkin caustics, in a sense, are symplectic invariant.
Just
so
remember the
game
starts at 3.
Well, that's why I'm writing the content. Maybe you'll contemplate. So basically, the main result plus a solution of extension problem can solve one of those conjectures. And as you will see, extension problem has very strong KEM type of flavor. I hope I'll still have time to tell you about ideas from the proof. We have a preliminary manuscript available. And so since the game starts at 3, let me be somewhat fast. So what are the convex billiards? You pick a convex-shaped body. So this is strictly convex. And I really want to do strictly convex case. And let me assume that the boundary is C4. Let me assume that the length of the boundary is 1. If not, I will scale my object, and let me assume that S is the lens parametrization of the boundary. The billiard map problem acts as follows. You pick your gamma of S where it is parameterized by S, and you shoot the ball with the angle phi. It goes all the way, and then it hits a point with a parametrization S prime, and it hits it with an angle phi prime, then angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. So what we get a map. S phi goes to S prime phi prime. And since we have a program in symplectic dynamics, let me tell you the symplectic nature of this map. So if you look at the function which gives you a distance between the points parameterized by S and S prime, then it's a generating function of this map. In other words, if I take a derivative of S with then I'll get a phi. If I take a derivative with respect to S prime, I'll get F prime. And a very simple lemma says that F is symplectic. It preserves the area form sine phi d phi ds. And L is actually a generating function. So this is my main mathematical model. And now what I would like to do, I will start defining objects for this mathematical model, which is a length spectrum. So what I need to find a variety of periodic orbits for my billiard problem. So there exists a simple lemma by Birkhoff, which says that if you pick any two numbers, integers, then there exist at least two orbits, at least two periodic orbits, two period Q orbits, turning exactly P times. So, for example, this orbit has p equal to 1 or 2, depending on the orientation. Q is equal to 3. You could have a pentagon. So for the pentagon, p is going to be 2 or 3, depending on orientation. And Q is going to be equal to 5. So why do I need all of this? Because I want to define a component of length spectrum. So L is going to be, L is a perimeter of a PQ orbit. And the Birkhoff's lemma says that you always have at least two, so you will get something which is not empty. And so what is the length spectrum? The length spectrum is you take a union over all integers p and q of all these lengths. And I actually made a mistake here, because what I want to do, I want to multiply also by a natural number, and I also want to add the spectrum coming from the boundary. So this is called length spectrum. And very much motivated by Kat's question, there is a very natural question that if you have two domains for which the length spectra are the same, does it imply that the domains are the same? Yeah, I count with multiplicity. If you want, you could say generically, and then you will have all the distances, and then you can eliminate multiplicities. So one more thing which I'd like to say is that F is a symplectic map. And actually, the length spectrum is symplectic invariant in the sense that if you will change if you conjugate F with a symplectic morphism to a different symplectic map, then actually these perimeters will not change. So probably a different conjecture could be whether the length spectrum gives you a complete set of symplectic invariants. But I will be interested in so-called marked length spectrum. And let me define what it is. So marked length spectrum, it takes into account not all periodic orbits, but only the periodic orbits which, let me take zero out. L M of, I should intersect with Q, a map into R, and then P over Q is equal to minus, and then what I do, I take a maximal P perimeter in L omega PQ, and then I normalize it by Q. So basically, what you do, you look at all your periodic orbits, and whenever you have a periodic orbit with Q legs, you normalize your periodic, here I don't want to normalize, I want to normalize here. So this is minus M L omega P Q divided by Q. So marked length spectrum, it's when you count only points with maximal perimeter, or in the language of Abri-Mazur theory, you look only at minimizers because it comes with a minus sign. And based on a marked length spectrum, so this is called marked length spectrum. Based on the marked length spectrum, I define a so-called beta function. So this is Mazur beta function. And it turns out that this function, and this is was proved by Mazur in the 80s, it turns out that this function is convex. And because this function is convex, you could extend it to all omegas in 0, 1. And as a result, there is a unique way. If you have a beta function, then you could determine marked length spectrum. Or if you have marked length spectrum, you can determine beta function. And a question which is quite similar to this one says that if marked length spectrum of two domains is the same, which is equivalent to beta functions being the same, does it imply that the domains are the same? Yes. Actually, you mean these ones or these ones? These ones are not necessarily like this. For these ones, you could think of a twist map. And for twist map, you have islands. And inside of the islands, there are orbits which don't obey ordering condition. These ones are minimal. And these ones do obey ordering condition. But yeah, actually, these ones and that ones are quite different. And I will stick to this case. And yeah. Well, when you have two convex domains, then equal means if you could scale and rotate one into the other. Because if you, well, in this case, I don't think you could scale, but you could certainly rotate. There is a conjecture by Guillemin and Melrose, but I think this conjecture much more makes sense for symplectic manifolds. So what you could take a length spectrum, which is, as I said, is symplectic invariant, and what you could do, you could add eigenvalues of periodic orbits, the conjecture is that the conjecture is that if you have two domains with the same length spectrum plus eigenvalues of periodic orbits, then this implies that the domains are the same, I should say, symplectically equivalent. Well, in this case, for the case of billiards, it does mean that they are the same. And this in turn implies that if F1 and F2 are billiard maps, then it means that they are conjugate. There exists H such that F2 is equal to H inverse F1 H. So you take a periodic orbit, you take the corresponding Poincaré map, and for the corresponding Poincaré map, you compute the differential. Linearize your operator, and for linearized operator, you can. Yeah, of the monodromy operator. Yeah, because the soccer is at 3 o'clock, I don't talk about Laplace spectrum, because you could go this way, but you cannot go that way. As you can see, in this question, the question of conjugacy arises. And then let me formulate the third question, which I found a reference on the web to Guillemin, but I sent him an email, but he didn't reply. So I didn't find an article where he states this question, but on the web there is a web page of Neil, and he states this as an open problem. So if you have two billiards, billiard maps, F and G are conjugate, then the domains are the same. And again, the same means you could scale and rotate one into the other. And I'll say that the main result, I would say, answers it. Let me continue, and then you'll see what is the problem. The question is of smoothness of conjugacy. There is an easy counterexample. So here's an easy counterexample. Billiard maps in an ellipse, in an ellipse, in any ellipse, are C0 conjugate. So when you look at the billiard problem in the ellipse, and you look at the coordinate system which I introduced over there, then it's actually a pendulum. And because it's a pendulum, you could deform one billiard map into the other. And now let me make the main result clear. So that let F and G be CR billiard maps. Where R is at least 2. And let's suppose H is C1 plus Hölder conjugacy near the boundary. With alpha is at least 1/2, then the domains are the same. So that's the main result. And so, Peter, to answer your question, if you don't impose any smoothness, he put topologically. I mean, since he didn't reply to my email, I don't know what Guillemin put. What Neil puts is that they are topologically conjugate. But if topologically conjugate, then it doesn't make sense. No, you see.
I mean, you said that they're conjugate.
No, no, C0. C0. C0.
But, I mean, you can deduce the eigenvalues from the C0. For the circles going around it, you can deduce the period.
Mm-hmm. But it's still C0.
Yeah, you can deduce P over 2, and you go to the limit, and you go to the eigenvalue, and that gives you the.
But you need some additional regularity, no? So you're saying it's not continuous at the, it's not uniformly continuous, no?
No, I'm saying that I think that you can get the eigenvalue at the elliptic point from the C0 conjugacy.
Well, maybe we'll talk to each other. So in any case, we'll probably, you mean here?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, we can talk. So in any case, what I would like to emphasize that this result says the following, that when you look at the billiard dynamics of one domain, and when you look at the billiard dynamics at another domain, then if they are conjugate to each other, then if conjugacy is smooth, that there is a rigidity which doesn't allow one domain to be conjugate to another domain, and I'm really talking about a tiny neighborhood of the boundary where they are both C0 conjugate. So now what I would like to do, I would like to tell you there is a simple corollary out of this, which answers some form of Birgov conjecture, but I mean in a very weak form. So, so the Birgov conjecture says that the only integrable near the boundary convex billiard is an ellipse. So here's a conditional Birkhoff conjecture. So the conditional Birkhoff conjecture says that if F is a billiard map, is an integrable billiard map, C1 alpha conjugate to elliptic billiard near the boundary then sigma omega is an ellipse. So as I said, the classical question of Birkhoff says that once your billiard is integrable near the boundary, then the only possibility that you have an integrable billiard near the boundary is that this billiard has to be an ellipse, and this is a huge open problem. So the main result says that there should be some irregularity of conjugacy if you want to have an integrable behavior, because you could actually C0 conjugate, there is always C0 conjugacy of an integrable billiard and elliptic billiard, this C0 conjugacy is easy to construct. And the second corollary, which was actually bothering me for quite a while, says that near the boundary of the circle and near the boundary of ellipse, billiard maps are not C1 plus alpha conjugate. So maybe I'll draw an illustration of this theorem, because this is quite counterintuitive. So what does it say? So billiard in the circle has very simple dynamics. You could think that billiard in the circle is just a rotation of concentric circles by a different angle. And if you look at the billiard in the ellipse, then for the billiard in the ellipse, it's a rotation of co-focal ellipses. So you have analytic foliation by concentric circle. Here you have an analytic foliation by co-focal ellipses. Here, using elliptic functions, you can compute first integrals, compute all the rotation numbers, and then when you are trying to conjugate one to another, then there is a hidden problem with the conjugacy. And actually, this turns out that the curvature of the boundary prevents these two domains to be conjugate. And now, I guess, to motivate the reader, so let me recall that there was a question two, which would say that Mark Lund spectrum of one implies whether this question has an answer yes or no. Here's how I characterize the main result. So if you take the main result, and I will spend the next 20 minutes explaining you what is the extension problem, which has very much KAM flavor. And they, too, imply that the answer is yes. So I would say, so there is one thing is that there is a main result, but maybe outside of a dynamical community, the result might not look that interesting. So my goal of the next 20 minutes is to explain you what is an extension problem, because actually what I claim is that smoothness of the conjugacy on a counter set, which I will define in a moment, is actually seems to be a technical key in order to answer this question positively. And this is what I'm going to explain right now. So in order to explain, I would like to introduce something which turns out to be a symplectic invariant. Namely, I would like to introduce the family of caustics, which were found by Lazutkin. And this will be one of the basic objects I would like to investigate. So Lazutkin caustics. Basically, I have a billiard map, I'm interested in small phi. So let me remind you that phi is an angle with which I bounce. So what Lazutkin found, he found a smart change of coordinates, and this smart change of coordinates turned out to be symplectic. So for people in symplectic geometry, if you make a symplectic change of coordinates, it's not a problem. All the symplectic invariants should stay the same. And after you make this symplectic change of coordinates, I think it's 16. So you make a symplectic change of coordinates, and after you make this symplectic change of coordinates, then what you see a map which actually looks seemingly much simpler, at least so-called KAM theory applies. So I have A plus A omega I to the power 1/2 plus O capital of I to the power 3/2 and I plus O capital of I to the power 5/2. So it turns out that if you pick some magic glasses and find some nice change of coordinates. Then after the change of coordinates, if you for a second forget about the higher order terms, this is just an integrable twist map. And this integrable twist map has a counter set. It has plenty of invariant curves. So let me draw an impressionistic picture, is that this map actually, even after you add high order terms, it has a family, a counter set of invariant curves, where this direction is phi and this direction is s. So it turns out that if you use some KAM theory, then, and this is what Lazutkin did, then KAM theory says that F sub L has a counter set of positive measure, counter set C of invariant curves. And if somebody thinks that this is a cheap application of KAM, I want to assure that it's not that cheap, because actually square root is not differentiable and there is a singularity. It's not that you need to work hard, but you need to work in order to make the construction work, a KAM construction. So basically what I would like to say is that if you have your billiard map F, then near the boundary there exists some counter set CF. Maybe I could have called it LF due to Lazutkin, but the map is due to Lazutkin. And actually what Kovachev and Popov proved, that this is symplectic invariant. So what does it mean? It means that if marked length spectrum of one domain is equal to marked length spectrum of another domain, then F restricted to CF is conjugate, is symplectically conjugate to G restricted to CG. So it turns out that if you just restrict yourself to the picture which is given by this counter set, which is approaching the boundary, then actually you see a symplectic invariant. And certainly the question is whether it's a full set of symplectic invariant. Namely, if you know this, whether you could go backward and could restore the domain. Now you go back to the proof, and actually let me replace this part and say that H is C alpha conjugate on the Lazutkin set.
I think Lazutkin constructs these acoustics, many of them. You have your definition of CF.
In the sense of Whitney, in the sense of Whitney. So now I want conjugacy when I restrict to the counter set. Well, you give a definition of Diophantine number, the one which you feel is okay. You apply KAM, and then there is a positive measure set of invariant curves here. You take the union with them and the boundary, and you call it Lazutkin set. And the boundary. And the boundary. Now, what I am saying here is that the proof works fine if you have a conjugacy not on the neighborhood of the boundary, but if you have sufficiently smooth conjugacy when you restrict yourself to a symplectic invariant, which is the Lazutkin set. So the main result says that it's enough to have conjugacy between two billiards, which is C1 plus Hölder in the sense of Whitney. If you have such a conjugacy, then the domains are the same. And now I'm ready to tell you what is an extension problem. So the extension problem basically says that whenever you have two symplectic maps which have the same marked length spectrum, then there is a conjugacy. So let F and G, F, L, G, L, be of the form like this. And have the same beta functions. And having the same beta functions means that the length spectrum of one domain, marked length spectrum of one domain, is equal to marked length spectrum of the other domain. Then F and G are C1 restricted to the Lazutkin set, C1 alpha conjugate, simple C1 alpha conjugate. So basically what I'm saying is that if you take any convex domain, strictly convex, and apply Lazutkin procedure, then you will get this particular kind of map. The map, the only parameter in the leading order term which depends on the symplectic information is A sub delta, and it depends on the so-called Lazutkin perimeter. But if it happens that you have a domain F and domain G which have the same marked length spectrum which is encoded in this map. So if F and G have the same marked length spectrum or equivalently the same beta functions, then the conjugacy on the counter set has to be of higher regularity. And if the conjugacy on the counter set has higher regularity, then the main result implies that the domains are the same. Okay? So, this question can already be attacked with KAM tools, I don't know, Håkan, did you have a chance to solve it? No, but it's at least you can approach it, right? At least you can approach the question. At this point, there are tools in KAM theory which one could hope to use, and there is a definite path which you could go, and hopefully this path will give us a needed conjugacy, and it shouldn't be trivial, because if beta functions are not the same, it implies that conjugacy is not that smooth. So it follows from the main result that if beta functions are not the same, and this is intrinsic information encoded in the marked length spectrum, so if you change marked length spectrum a little bit, beta functions will fill it, and the twist maps are not going to be conjugate. Are there any questions? So then I'll tell you the idea of the proof. I mean, the proof is not very long. This one. So another way to put it, it's a billiard map in Lazutkin coordinates. If you want to forget about Lazutkin coordinates, since Lazutkin map is smooth, you can say the billiard maps restricted to Lazutkin set are conjugate. Okay. I'm just using this form to attach it to something, but okay. This big O, yeah, this is a big O. This is a big O. Right. It's only diophantine rotation numbers which lie on the counter set. And actually, there is a work of Lazutkin where using this counter set, he obtains some approximations to Laplace spectrum. Yeah, so it carries symplectic information, but I'm saying it's enough. I believe it's enough. Yeah, yeah. It's enough to. Okay, so now let me give you some flavor of the proof. So I guess the proof starts with it's been some time since I thought why the billiard maps are special. So for a long time I've studied Abri-Mazur theory for twist maps, and actually the billiard map is a twist map. But why the billiard map is special? What is so special in it? And I mean, there is something I spoke to Tabachnikov, who seems to be the main expert in it. So I start with a trivial remark. So when you do the billiard map, it's a twist map of two variables. But all the information about this map is encoded in the curvature of the boundary. Right? If you give me a curvature of the boundary, I will recover the domain. And then you go and look how to incorporate into the billiard twist map curvature of the boundary. And there are many formulas which you could write. But near the boundary, what you could do, you could actually write the differential of the map. And it turns out the differential has the following form. So it's a fairly easy computation, a little lengthy. So it turns out that the leading term is this one. And then the next order term is given as follows. I want to introduce a function which is a derivative of the curvature and put a -2/3 here. Then if I put -2/3, then the higher order term has the following shape. So this gives you a leading order term, and then you say, suppose I have a conjugacy. Suppose F is given H inverse G H. So you differentiate it. And now I'll start making little mistakes, which are correctable, but in order to explain the flavor, I need to do this. So what you could do, you could subtract identity from both sides, but in a little smart way. So one conjugacy is inside, another is outside. Yes, there is one term missing, but it's you can actually control it. Now you get a conjugacy of this type. What you want to do, you want to look at it more carefully. And since I want to analyze everything for a small parameter phi, let me say that dh, which depends on s and phi, I want to decompose it into two terms. Forget about C1 Hölder, it's becomes a little technical. So suppose it's differentiable. So I have lambda of s plus phi lambda 1 of s. So let me look at order 1 terms. So if you look on order 1 terms on both sides, look, L minus identity has this form. And this is a matrix which is not easy to conjugate to. Now you have lambda inverse. And now you have another matrix which is also not easy to conjugate to. You see how something like this is happening. it's an easy computation says that lambda is upper triangular. And then you look at the entries of lambda, and then you see that actually A divided by C is equal to, I hope I'll get it right, either this one or the other one, or the inverse of it. And actually, if you look at things a little bit more carefully, you can compute A and B. Then you then you look at order phi terms. And when you look at the order phi terms, then I'm skipping some terms which you need to work in order to show that they are negligible. So there are some others. And actually, if you look carefully into the others, then it turns out that lower left term is O capital of phi. So it turns out that if you analyze some symplectic information included into the boundary, then this is negligible. But not everywhere. Only one term of the matrix fills the curvature. And now if you start looking at the information encoded there, so you have AF, which is something like this, and then there exists this special term. I could even write it. It's minus. Well, it's some non-zero term. So this is R F of S, rho F of S, and you want to conjugate it with. You want to make it equal into A inverse something, D inverse, C inverse something. There is rho g of s, rho g of s, and there is something. And then you apply A something, C something. And then you end up with ORF of s, RF of s is equal to RG of s, rho g of s. And this is a pointwise. So basically, if you start analyzing the curvature information encoded into the next order, first you analyze the first order term, which is already quite rigid. Then from the first order term, you actually obtain some information about your conjugacy matrix. And actually, when you compose these three matrices, I don't know if it makes sense in the lecture, this lower left term, when you are composing with an upper triangular matrix, is easy to compute. And actually, this one is computed by the ratio of A and C. So ratio of A and C times this one is given by the previous order term. So you plug it in. I'm sorry. After you plug it in and do the calculation, you get this one. So what it tells you, that so this tells you that 1 over curvature of one of them is equal to 1 over curvature of the other one. And then integral of curvature is 2 pi. So you do some simple inequalities, and you end up with the fact that the curvatures are the same. And the reason you need to have some additional regularity, because you see, if h is only continuous, I'm not sure you could carry this calculation, because I left out maybe 5 different terms. But if you have some regularity, then you could actually go through these calculations. I don't think 1/2 is optimal. I think if you are desperate, you could work harder and could probably get 1/3 or 1/4. And the point is that you need to analyze this conjugacy, which has very special form encoded in the curvature. And I don't know, I mean, if somebody's interested, I have a preprint. So I don't know, I guess especially because the game starts in 10 minutes. I guess I'll stop here.